Hello everyone and welcome to this third and final episode in a series of three videos where I'm showing you my complete end-to-end photo life cycle. From covering in the first episode how and where I store my photos after I downloaded them from the camera and how I manage my catalog. In the second episode, I talked about how I select the photos that I want to edit and keep for the future. And in this third and final episode, I want to talk about my long-term archiving process, meaning how I store my photos for the future. If you are new to the channel or you just stumbled across this video and you're just interested in this process alone, you don't have to watch episode 1 and 2 because I will make sure that this video can stand completely on its own and explains the process without you having to watch episode 1 or 2. I will still make sure to link both of those videos in the description below in case you're interested either now and then come back to this video or if you want to watch them after you've watched this video. But let's get started with the long-term archiving process, which I also sometimes call a little bit of an overkill, but it somehow gives me peace of mind. And maybe we will find out during the course of this video why this process that I've developed over the years gives me this peace of mind. I want to start off with this little hard drive that I showed already in the first episode of this mini-series. This is a small USB-C SSD drive where I store all my current or active projects. And I choose to do so because I want to be able to move with my photos from my laptop to my PC and have it with me on the go if I'm on a vacation or on the road in general. I can be sure that if I have this drive with me, I have my catalog and my photos always here. Now, when I am done editing those photos, I will always do an export of the edits into a JPEG and TIFF format. And this is already the first step in my long-term archiving process. Because JPEG and TIFF are more robust file formats than the cataloging software that we are using, be it Capture One in my case, or maybe you use Adobe Lightroom or any other cataloging software. I have also moved catalogs over the years a lot, and I never had a really painless transition from one tool to the other. So I was always glad that I had my final edits exported, because if I would have only just had the raw files and the edits in the cataloging software, never exported them, then I would have been stuck or I would have lost all my edits. So in order to be future-proof and also be independent of the tool or whatever happens to the vendor, I can highly recommend to you to also have that as one of the first steps to create a JPEG and a TIFF file out of your edits. And also those are file formats that are better suited for publishing either for social media or if you want to create prints or a photo book or print posters, for example. So that is the first step. Now, when I have my JPEGs and TIFFs exported on this drive, what I will do as a first step is I will copy the files from this little drive to my network attached storage. Now, for those who don't know what a network attached storage, or also called NAS, is, it is a device that is connected to the network, for example, at your home or your office, and all the laptops or PCs or phones and iPads can connect to it without having a direct cable connection. So as long as the devices are on the same network, for example, a Wi-Fi, they can reach the network attached storage. It also means that no matter if I want to copy the files from my laptop from this little drive or from my PC, I can easily do that because both of those devices can connect to the network attached storage. Another advantage of these network attached storage devices or NAS are that they have, as you can see here, multiple hard drive slots. In my case, I use NAS systems with 5 slots. That means in my case, I put 5 hard drives into these slots. And I configure the NAS in such a way that I have a redundancy of 2 disks. Or that means when 2 of the disks fail simultaneously, basically at the same time, and 3 of them are still okay, my photos are safe. And this is also why I use such a device and not one of these portable hard drives that you see here and that might look familiar to you. Maybe you are using one of these devices yourself. So I will explain later why I have these devices here, because they are part of my process, but they are not my main storage. So for my peace of mind, I always prefer having my files on a NAS with 5 disks where 2 of those 5 can fail. Now, I have these disks here because once a month, what I will do is I will copy or mirror the photos from the NAS onto one of these 2 drives. So these are basically my ultimate fail-safe in case, for example, the whole NAS stops functioning, or I have some water damage or fire or I don't know what. So far, nothing ever happened, but just in case anything happens to the NAS, I know that I have another copy, another offline copy. Now, what you can do, what I don't do, and maybe I should, is to have this second offline copy at a different location, not in my own apartment, for example. But so far, I don't do that. But again, this would be something to consider as well. So this now describes my offline archiving process. Just to quickly reiterate, from this little disk connected to one of my PCs or laptops, I do a transfer of all my completed projects to my NAS, which will protect it against 2 hard drive failures. And then once a month, I do a mirror of all the data from the NAS to one of these drives here as a second backup. And this basically is the workflow for my long-term offline archive. And I'm saying offline because as soon as I leave my apartment, I will not have access to the NAS, or at least I configure the NAS in such a way that it cannot be reached from the internet. So I did that because of privacy or security reasons. I don't like to have my NAS exposed to the internet. But having said that, I have an online copy of all the photos that are important for me, and I choose to use Flickr for that. Now, chances are that some of you who are watching this video have never heard of Flickr or have used Flickr in the past and don't use it anymore. But I personally think Flickr is still one of the greatest online tools for us photographers to archive our photos, especially if you have the pro subscription and you can download the original JPEGs. So, all the photos that are dear to my heart and that I don't want to ever lose, I copy from time to time from my NAS to Flickr. And in Flickr, you can configure if you want to show the photos to everyone, so make them public, or have them, for example, just exposed to friends and family, or have them completely set to private. Now, you may choose or not choose to trust Flickr with your files, and this is absolutely up to you. I use Flickr since 2005, and I'm very happy with the service, and it also adds to my peace of mind, right? So I have this online copy of all my important photos stored on Flickr. And I use it because not only that I like it and I use it for a while, but Flickr has amazing apps that I can use to show photos on the go to friends and family, for example, but also I can browse through my photos in a graphical way. I can tag them and create collections and albums similar to a photo catalog in Lightroom or Capture One, for example, which normal cloud drives like Google Drive or iCloud would not give me. So I think for photography, right, just for this niche, maybe Google Drive and so on and so forth are better for other things. But for photography, I think nothing beats Flickr, if you ask me. If you have any other suggestions, I would be actually curious to hear it. And you can leave a comment below. I would be really interested to know. But so far, I don't know of a better service with basically unlimited storage for my online long-term archive. So again, just to recap, I have an offline long-term archive stored on my NAS in the basically apartment in my private network, and it contains all my work, the raw files, JPEGs and TIFFs from the last 15 years. And I have an online archive with just the JPEGs in original quality on Flickr. And that quality is more than enough if you want to, for example, create prints either for a post or a photo book. So I think that is very convenient. And with this, I want to conclude this video or this topic. I don't want to go into which tooling I'm using or how I'm doing certain things, because this would blow this video up tremendously. But nonetheless, if you have a specific question how I'm doing one of these steps, feel free to ask them in a comment section below or shoot me an email, for example. I'm happy to answer your questions. Also, if you have generally questions to this process, I would be curious to learn from you and also curious to learn from you how you are doing it. So if you want, we can have a discussion in the comment section below. I would be very happy. If you liked this video, please also don't forget to hit the like button. It helps me and the channel a lot. And if you're not subscribed to the channel and you like this video and you want to see more, please also subscribe to the channel. That also helps me. But as always, thank you so much for being here with me and having watched this video. And I hope to see you in the next video. Bye-bye.